Good morning. The February 3rd Board of Education meeting is now in session. Are your microphones on? Oh, well, she was going to play.
Let me try again.
I know.
Hello, parents and employees. This is Anne Arundel County Public Schools calling with a bit of a different sound to the messages you've been receiving all week.
All right, that was our call to order. Please rise for the invocation.
If I had it.
Oh God, we pray to administer that which is just in all educational policies, being ever mindful of your guidance, stir us to action with love, wisdom, and understanding.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item 2.03 is approval of the minutes. Do I have a motion to approve the minutes?
Second.
All those in favor? Minutes are approved. Item 2.04, establish agenda order, and the agenda will stand as published. Item 2.05 is recognitions, but we do not have any recognitions this morning. 2.06 is Educator of the Month, Mrs. Nally.
Good morning. When we ask a certain teacher at South River High School to describe her department, she said, "I work in an exceptionally harmonious and productive department, and I would contribute this pleasant ambiance to our leader. Our department works as a highly functioning team under her leadership." These words came from a colleague of our Educator of the Month, who happens to be her former student as well. The department, World and Classical Languages, the leader, Ms. Karen Packle. Karen Packle comes to work every day ready to give her all and willing to try new ideas. Administration can always count on her department because they know that Karen has it covered and that tasks will get done well and get done on time. She is a hardworking and helpful co-worker and an inspiring teacher. Her lessons are always well prepared, and she keeps up with the latest trends in education. She conducts department meetings on a regular basis and in an organized fashion. She shares her knowledge with her department members on a continuous basis, earning the utmost respect from her colleagues. Karen Packle is also the chairperson of the Faculty Council. As one who is often involved in representing the administration in Faculty Council meetings, her assistant principal has had this to say about our Educator of the Month. "I have found Karen to be calm and courteous even when issues are very contentious. Her sense of fairness permeates the meetings and has made South River's Faculty Council one of the most productive groups in the building. She is the instrument that keeps the faculty and administration working together. Karen Packle is a quiet leader who leads by example. She exhibits a high degree of professionalism by strictly adhering to the rules of the school and district as a whole. In doing so, she inspires other teachers in the department to enthusiastically follow the policies of the district. She is always available to assist any department member in any way she can. She encourages teachers in her department to partake in school spirit-related activities, and by doing so, she brings the faculty closer together. Karen Packle, you are loved by students and staff alike. There is no teacher in the building that commands more respect. You have been a faithful Anne Arundel County Public School employee for the past 42 years. And throughout those years, you have been involved in so many programs and initiatives to not only improve your school, but the community and school system as a whole. So, on behalf of the Board of Education, I wish to congratulate you on the well-deserved recognition of Educator of the Month for February 2016.
certificate and a bell. And tell me how they got you here today.
They told me that I was going to be discussing faculty council issues, that there was another school that had difficulties. They wanted to try to improve their faculty council by modeling it after hours.
That was really a good story.
Item 2.07 is Employee of the Month. Mrs. Hummer.
The year was 1989. The school was Crofton Woods, and the event was our Employee of the Month walking through the front door on her first day of work, ready to perform her magic. Little did she know that 27 years later, Nyla Brown would be here at the board being honored for her excellent service and dedication to Anne Arundel County Public Schools. That's the best surprise face ever. Over the years, Nyla Brown's service to Crofton Woods Elementary has been exemplary. She has demonstrated dependability and loyalty during her tenure. If one could describe Nyla in one word, it would be resourceful. She is the Crofton Woods version of Radar from the TV show MASH. She is clairvoyant and always anticipating what she knows is to come. Nyla is so attuned to what's happening in the school and the community that she will oftentimes finish your sentence for you. She uses her wit consistently to support administration and staff by putting everyone and everything into place so that the students at Crofton Woods are safe, sound, and ready to learn each day. Mrs. Brown is known for her phrase, "Just let me know what you need and I will take care of it." She is known for her amazing memory that enables her to recall names and events from the present and the past. She makes students, families, and business partners feel special as she greets them by name and remembers something about them. Mrs. Brown is a highly valued, trusted confidant of the school principal. Her outstanding work and personal ethics are impeccable. She maintains confidentiality of records and a professional demeanor. Mrs. Brown has proven time and time again she is a dependable and reliable employee. She is a star arranging for the best substitutes on a daily basis, which is an example of her goal to have each and every school day operate efficiently and fully staffed. Mrs. Brown has been in charge of registration for nearly two decades at Crofton Woods. She works collaboratively with other secretaries, reading team, administration, PPWs, teachers, guidance counselor, health room, family, central office, and other schools to ensure a smooth transition and warm welcome to Crofton Woods. Nyla Brown, in addition to your excellent work product, we know you have a big heart. You make the teachers and staff at Crofton Woods feel like family. Your passion and loyalty are contagious. So on behalf of the Board of Education, the teachers, staff, and students at Anne Arundel County Public Schools, congratulations on being recognized Employee of the Month for February 2016.
Now you can really bring it up.
And we're going to take some pictures afterwards, so stay around. 2.08 is Volunteer of the Month, Mr. Horsky.
Thank you. When few parents are available to volunteer in their children's school during the day, it's especially appreciated when those who can do, especially when the volunteers thoughtfully create, initiate, and efficiently coordinate enriching events for students and staff. At Crofton Woods Elementary School, Mrs. Karen Lucas is that very special and that very appreciated volunteer. And so, today the Board of Education is proud to honor you as our February Volunteer of the Month. For at least 4 years, Mrs. Lucas has dedicated her exceptional creativity and organizational skills to the Crofton Woods Elementary School students, staff, and families. Even though two of her children are now in middle school, her willingness to continue to accept responsibilities and carry through with dependable competency enables the Crofton Woods teachers to spend their time teaching instead of designing and managing additional events. Karen not only serves as the perfect room parent who rallies other parents and brilliantly organizes holiday parties, but she always stands ready to help all teachers with small tasks such as photocopying or large special projects. Fifth grade teacher Kyle Lynch explained, "It's never about just her son's classroom. Karen truly supports the entire school community." Karen loves the fourth grade Arlington Echo overnight trip, so much so that for her second year in a row, she devoted herself to ensuring a wonderful experience for both students and teachers. Karen devoted countless hours playing with teachers and handling trip preparation details. She recruited volunteers and created all the participants' name badges. Karen wrote up each student's organizational information, including their cabin placement, dining assignments, and group rotation schedule. All parent volunteers know their precise schedules and tasks. "Believe me when I say that the trip would not have worked without her," exclaimed a grateful fourth grade teacher, Elizabeth Heinlein. Soon after the Arlington Echo trip, Karen initiated an outreach project in which fourth grade provided Thanksgiving baskets to struggling families. Ms. Heinlein writes, "I love that Karen took the time to engage the whole class. She planned the menus, invited their families to contribute, organized basket packing, and arranged the deliveries. This shared enriching experience led to thoughtful classroom discussions about gratitude and helping others in need." Fellow volunteer Lindsay O'Sullivan admires Karen's calm demeanor, even during apparent pandemonium, and her willingness to be selfless to service to the community. Indeed, Karen epitomizes what it means to be a volunteer. Thank you, Mrs. Lucas. Would you please come forward? With great appreciation, I present the Volunteer of the Month Spirit and Bell to you.
Congratulations to everybody. The next item is 2.09, School and Community Highlights. And I wanted to take a moment of executive privilege to thank, on behalf of all of our board members, our superhero custodians.
Oh, that was good. That was good. That was good.
I know many of us had a chance to thank them personally at various schools during Snowzilla, but we could not have reopened schools even a week later without all of their help and support. So we're very, very grateful. Mrs. Hummer.
Right before the snow, we had the opportunity to go to the pinning ceremony for the new National Board Certified Teachers. There were is it 29, 30, mm-hmm. something like that, and a very impressive bunch, the rock stars of the teaching world. And I loved it personally because one of my son's teachers is one, and that I loved, and another close friend. And I loved hearing Mr. Liverman point out that a couple of them were people he hired when he was, you know, a principal. So it was a very inspiring group, and that was a fun event to do. And then last weekend, my daughter participated with Team Chili Pepper, which was staff and teachers from Brock Bridge Elementary and Ruth Eason, in the Polar Plunge for Maryland Special Olympics. And I know many of our students will be participating in that, the rescheduled one for this Saturday. And that's a wonderful event. And it's great to see so many of our students and staff out there plunging. And no, I do not plunge. I stand on the shore and hold all the towels for the others. I'm very good at that. And so I go every year and support in that way. But it's a great event, and I love seeing so many of our people out there supporting Maryland Special Olympics. So.
Mrs. Ritchie.
Just real quickly, last night I had the opportunity to attend the North County Forum on the School Start and Dismissal Times, and it was there was a lot of diverse people there, and that was really great. And just a reminder that there's one on Thursday at South River, starts at 6:30, and then on the following Monday, there's one at Old Mill. And encourage people to go out to those to share. The board sees all the information that's provided at those, and it's real important that we hear all voices and to know what everybody's thinking for us to be able to make decisions. So just wanted to remind that and thank those that were able to come out last night.
And the last thing that I wanted to mention is that Friday we had the opportunity, many of us went to the delegation just to update our senators and, mostly our House of Representatives folks about our legislative priorities for this year for the school system. And that was very well received. And we thank Dr. Arlotto for answering all the questions for us. Dr. Frank?
I'd like to use this opportunity to make a brief announcement that this coming Saturday at Chesapeake Charter School, there's going to be a science fair, and the folks at the science fair were kind enough to invite me to be a judge. So while I'm there judging, I will be judging to see how many of you come. I hope you will be there. It's a wonderful opportunity to see kids in our school understand the essence of science and their participation voluntarily in this program. So I'll look forward to seeing you there, snow or not.
Okay, item 2.10 is the CAC report, and we do not have a report today. So we are going to take a little break for pictures of the Educator, Employee, and Volunteer of the Month, if you guys could all meet us out in the hallway.
Thank you.
Anyone wishing to speak on an item not on today's agenda may offer testimony during this public comment portion of the meeting. Speakers will be allotted 3 minutes each, and the board asks that comments remain civil and appropriate for the various audiences that may be watching or viewing the meeting. Student-specific and personnel matters are confidential and cannot be discussed in this forum. This time is intended for speakers to voice their opinion and not necessarily as a question and answer period. Speakers may pose questions, but answers will be counted toward the 3 minute allotment. For the record, please give your name before speaking, and handouts should be given to the board assistant. I have two cards this morning, Lisa Van Buskirk and Janet Norman.
Members of the board and Dr. Arlotto, Lisa Van Buskirk of Start School Later. I commend you for the forum last night. There were many elements which were taken straight from the blueprint for change. Most important, it was Dr. Arlotto himself discussing the change with Ms. Ritchie and Dr. Frank in attendance, and the vast number of staff available for questions and group facilitation. Thank you. I truly appreciate the reference to the AAP and CDC guidelines, both at the forum last night and at the briefing to the Anne Arundel delegation last Friday. Is encouraging just how much you have embraced those recommendations for middle and high school start times as your benchmark for success. When Anne Arundel County achieves these times, as I believe that they will, you'll have accomplished significant change for which you should be immensely proud. Every praise has its constructive criticism, though. Most of the attendees last night, unfamiliar with the issues, didn't really understand why the AAP and CDC recommended the change to allow more sleep. They do not understand the negative consequences of chronic sleep loss on physical and mental health, substance abuse, academics, and more that our teens encounter every day. I encourage you not just to reference the resources on the task force website, but share a quick list of why the change is important and why this change is for the benefit of all students over their entire AACPS career. Regarding the survey participants completed, if even Dr. Arlotto says he doesn't like the proposed start times, then how can anyone check the box that they like the proposal as written? There is significantly more space to explain why you're against the proposal than why you're in favor of it. If the goal is to show the community is against the proposed change, then you're succeeding. If the goal is to show community support, then you're failing. Perhaps consider amending your form to include boxes to check to describe the benefits of the plan that people would support, that people could support, like closing the achievement gap, mental health, depression, obesity, improved athletic performance, more. And speaking of broad community support, as if the support of the AAP, CDC, the Maryland Department of Health, Maryland Department of Education is enough. I remind you of the petition that was presented to you 3 years ago in 2013 with 3,400 signatures. Today I bring you 4,000. The significance is the 3,400 signatures in 3 months collected when this issue was not on anyone's radar and the AAP and CDC recommendations were still years in the making. And realizing the petition's purpose was served in 2013, Start School Later quit publicizing it. It references Superintendent Maxwell, Mr. Pruski as the board president, so it's obsolete. But it's important to know that people continue to find this petition linked in our bottom of our webpage and sign it, including in the days immediately following the release of the proposed bell schedule. I also bring to you 4 letters signed by Anne Arundel County Pediatricians practices that support the AAP and CDC recommendations. As a board, you're empowered to lead this change. You can manage the family inconveniences and improve the schedule the next year, but you cannot solve the health and safety problems affected by sleep deprivation by maintaining the status quo. The status quo is not something that we should be fighting when we know better. And lastly, because I can't stay for the discussion of Maryland legislation because of preschool pickup, I hope that you'll call my Saturday morning email urging your support for Orange Ribbon Bill for Healthy Hours. What would be a better crowning achievement for Anne Arundel County in this long slog to healthy and safe hours than to be awarded statewide recognitions by the Department of Education as the first school system in the state to meet the AAP and CDC recommendations. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Janet Norman. I'm the parent of an exhausted 10th grader and a 7th grader who has to get up for 7 a.m. band practice this morning. Thank you for hosting the Start Time Forum last night. I thought it was a really important step in reaching out to the community. I look forward to maybe some of the changes on the Start Time Forum, as Lisa had mentioned, because it is listed to say why all the inconveniences you don't like the start times. I'd love to give you many of the inconveniences why I don't like the current times. It's highly inconvenient that my husband can no longer exercise before work because he has to drive our son into high school And that's taking years off his life, but we think it's important to get our son's brain development working with sleep. It's inconvenient for me to be here today burning vacation hours from work, but it was important, so I did it. During this past week, during the snow days, I was working, but my high school son was off. So when a doctor's appointment came up, I, you know, inconvenient for my work, I took that. We went to get his third vaccine shot to protect against the human papillomavirus, as recommended by the American Academy of Pediatrics and the Centers for Disease Control. We didn't take any survey of our neighbors to see if they thought their daughters would be fine or if they thought they'd get cervical cancer. We did it because the nation's doctors told us it was important to do. So another example, as I went back to work this Monday morning, finally, kids are in school, major meetings going on, lots of deadlines. It was really inconvenient to get a call from Annapolis High School saying that my son was being carted off in an ambulance to the emergency room. You know, he's fine now. He had terrible abdominal pain, just debilitating to him. But basically, it's inconvenient to be a parent. And so you're going to hear a lot of testimony about all the school time changes that we have to adjust to. You know, it was inconvenient to have an elementary school that started at 9:10, but I had to pay for aftercare and before care. So we need to do the right thing. We know it's inconvenient, and we want to manage and help people improve the inconveniences, but they are not what should be driving the process. I was so heartened to hear the Recreation and Parks Department representative, Mr. Cheney, say that Crofton Middle School has before care because the parents asked for that. Why didn't I know that or all the rest of the community know? And he said, we're happy to offer it at other middle schools if parents want to request that. That's a huge problem solver for many of the parents. So we need to work through the inconveniences, but you need to sell the community that this is the right thing to do and we must do it. Our kids' health is too important. If you all know the name of teacher Krista McAuliffe, she died 30 years ago. She didn't return from space because it was inconvenient for the managers to change the shuttle launch time, even though the scientists told them that there would be dire consequences. We want you to know that inconvenience can't trump what we know is best to do for our kids, and honor her memory of trying to teach kids science by doing the right thing now. And we appreciate all your efforts. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't have any additional cards. Dr. Frank.
I want to thank everyone that has come here and talked on this subject. I wanted to make a few points on this subject of whether or if or how we change the start time. And the question at this point seems to be, the question is, how are we going to make that decision? And it seems like one way we might make that decision is to see how many people show up and how many raise their hands one way or another. We also might make the decisions simply based on the dollars. We could just decide whether or not we have the money, and then we could do it that way. Or we could base it on the science. Someone that has led the peer review, has read the peer review science, I would vote for the scientific point of view, but I'd like to hear the public come forward and explain their point of view. What is the rationale for your point of view? And then I hope we'll make a rational decision on that. It's up to the community. If everybody wants to start very early or very late, then I'm willing to go along with the community. But let's have a rational decision on it.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak before the board at this time? Okay, we'll move on to action items. Item 4.01 is administrative personnel appointments, and we do not have any today. Item 4.02, personnel. Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation, please.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend that the board approve the actions as stipulated on the attached sheets.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor? Motion passes, 9-0-0. Item 4.03 is new course approvals. This is an information to action item. Do I have a motion to move this from information to action?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? We now have an action item. Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend approval of these courses beginning in the 2016-2017 school year.
I just, I have a question on this this item out of curiosity. It's an AP capstone course, and I'm just curious how the AP assesses it for AP credit and how that transfers to our colleges and universities.
President Korblak, Dr. Arlotto, and members of the board, for the record, I'm Don Counts, Coordinator of Advanced Learning for Anne Arundel County Public Schools. This is a new course. The course did not even exist until the 14-15 school year and is technically a two-year course which has a seminar component and the second year, which is going to roll out this coming year, is the research component. It is really not unlike defending a thesis. I would have to go back to the College Board documentation to see how it is going to be evaluated. It's more of a portfolio assessment than an exam. As with any AP courses, there are variations among colleges and universities about what, how they count the credit, what they do or do not accept in terms of scoring. That's something I would have to research to see how colleges, because it is still relatively new, I don't know if colleges have a lot of experience, and they could very well be playing kind of a waiting game to see what this is going to look like, what volume of students participate in the course, and how it's going to pan out.
Are we doing the same thing for the PVA capstone class, or is that also AP?
No, PVA courses are not AP. AP courses have to be endorsed by the College Board and have to be assessed and documented in a fairly regimented manner. So nothing in PVA is an AP course.
So just for clarification, this is not our course that we've written.
This is not. This is from the
College Board's course that we're presenting that we would now like to begin to teach with our students. How it will be assessed, because they have to take it 2 years, correct?
Right.
And then the assessment, we're not sure what that assessment's going
to
look
like. I'd have to go back and look. They've published quite a bit of documentation on it, and my recollection from when they were first proposing it and piloting it, and for the record, I did express an interest in piloting the course in Anne Arundel County. However, we were not chosen for the pilot. If we had been, I'd probably be able to give you a lot more in-depth information about it. But it's more of a portfolio assessment, at least that is my understanding. And also based on this large research paper that is done with the assistance of a mentor working with a student. If you look at the steps students go through during this second year, the research year, it's really not too much different from defending a thesis or even a doctoral dissertation.
So the students will get, their report card would say AP.
It would say AP capstone.
And they would get the additional GPA points.
Right. It will be weighted as we do with any AP course in terms of the letter grade.
Okay. Thanks. Mrs. Hummer.
Which schools are going to be offering these classes?
Currently, it's only being offered at South River. They had submitted a proposal to the College Board, and they were accepted. So it does involve, at this point, a great deal of teacher professional development beyond what the College Board typically offers locally. My recommendation would be to keep it at one school and just see how it works, because it is still kind of an unknown quantity for us.
And what about the modern biotechnologies? Where is that going to be offered? Is that going to be at BEMA?
Good morning. That course is going to be offered at all of our STEM high schools.
All the STEM high schools. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Mr. Horscam?
So with the assessing of the AP research and seminar, would it be, I know you don't know exactly, but like, would it be like how the AP drawing or art classes send in a portfolio, so they submit it online? They don't have to sit through an exam or anything?
That's my understanding. I'd have to verify that.
Okay, and that's it. Thank you.
Dr. Frank?
Thank you very much for coming forward. Could you give us a brief synopsis of the content of the course?
It's a very good question, and I'll try to keep the answer short. It's a cross-disciplinary course. The first year, the seminar is really teaching students how to research something that doesn't just live in a specific domain. It would be looking at an issue, a global issue from multiple perspectives, whether it be through social sciences, through the scientific ramifications, even the artistic implications. The second year involves the student identifying a research problem that, again, doesn't just dwell in a single content area. It's really something that forces a student to view a problem from multiple perspectives, from the perspective of the social scientist, from the theoretical mathematician, from the artist, any number of perspectives, and craft a thesis, a well-researched and very extensive document based on their research. And again, throughout the process, working with a mentor to make sure that what they are doing really is of an appropriate scope and depth and complexity to warrant 2 years of devotion to this document they're working on.
Thank you very much. I wish you a lot of success.
Thank you.
Is there any public comment on this item? All those in favor? Motion passes 900. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next item are five policy revisions that are up for third reading. The first is item 4.04, workdays, summer schedules for schools, policy GAG. Dr. Arletto, your recommendation, please.
Yes, ma'am. Excuse me. I recommend approval of policy GAG, subject to final correction for style and format.
Second.
Are there any board comments on this item? Are there any public comments? All those in favor? Motion passes 900. The next policy is student attire and personal appearance code JCD, also for third reading. Dr. Arletto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend approval of policy JCD, subject to final correction for style and format.
Is there any board comments or questions? Any public comment? All those in favor? Motion passes 900. The next policy is student political activity code JCK, also a third reading. Dr. Arletto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend approval of policy JCK, subject to final correction for style and format.
Second.
Any board comment? Any public comment? All those in favor? Motion passes 900. The next policy is supervision of students code JF. Third reading. Dr. Arletto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend approval of policy JF, subject to final correction for style and format.
Any board comment? Any public comment? All those in favor? Motion passes 900.
Thank you.
Item 4.08, powers, duties, and responsibilities, superintendent, code CBB. Dr. Arletto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend approval policy CBB, subject to final correction for style and format.
Second.
Any board comment? Any public comment? All those in favor? Motion passes 900. Next, we have four policy revisions that are up for first reading. The first is item 4.09, technology use and security code DI. We have a short presentation.
Yes. The Technology Division brings policy DI to you for first reading. This policy was last updated August 7th, 1996. Anne Arundel County Public Schools provides employees, students, and at times third parties access to its technological resources. The updated policy and regulation provide comprehensive direction and guidance regarding the use of all technology equipment, software, related materials, electronic devices, and network systems. The policy will be posted on the website for 30 days for public comment, and we'll answer any questions you have related to this policy and regulation.
I don't have any board questions. Is there any public comment? All right. Oh, Mrs. Hummer.
That we haven't updated this since 1996. I'm like, do we even still have the technology from 96 today?
That's
pretty amazing.
Yes, and as Mr. Barlow reminds us, the concepts actually of the 1996 policy are still very true and relevant, but the names of the different types of equipments that we're using have changed. And so I'm going to let Mr. Barlow and Mr. Borkowski introduce themselves.
Good morning. For the record, Greg Barlow, Chief Information Officer.
Good morning. For the record, Mike Burkowski, Senior Manager of Information Security.
And so we will post it on the website so the public can comment if they have any comments to make. Thank you. The next policy, item 4.10, is professional staff promotions and appointments, policy GBP. And this is also a first reading.
I'm sorry. The Division of Human Resources brings policy GBP, professional staff promotion and appointments, to you for first reading. This policy was last updated November 7th, 1990. The updated policy ensures that the Board of Education is informed regarding the promotions and appointments for employees in Unit 5F and Unit 6. The policy will be posted on the website for 30 days public comment, and we'll answer any questions you have about it.
I don't have any board questions. Is there any public comment? All right, so we'll put that up in the, okay, Mrs. Birch.
So under the policy as it's currently written, who does it apply to? I understand who it's going to apply to in the future, but who would it have applied to in the past?
So unfortunately, this is one of those policies where our practice may not have aligned with
right.
What the policy says. And so I don't know if Ms. Bozella can speak more specifically, but we actually, forwarding the top three names has not been a practice.
Right.
Nor is it consistent with state law and the superintendent's authority to appoint positions. So I'm not sure which positions.
So the positions that I, when I inherited or when I was appointed to this position, the practice had been that the board was only given the final choice to the superintendent.
For which and units?
For Unit 5 senior manager level positions and all Unit 6 positions.
Now, if we were to have read this the way it was written, would it be every position in the system or... How would we have read it if we had taken it literally?
Well, typically we consider professional staff to be units 5.
All of unit 5. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes.
So this would change that to unit 5, just the senior manager.
Senior managers, because they're supervisory leadership positions. And so historically we've brought all of those before the board for your approval of the superintendent's recommendation.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much for that clarification.
Thank you. The next policy is School Safety Patrols, JEI, first reading.
The School Security Office brings policy JEI, School Safety Patrols, to you for first reading. This policy was last updated May 20th, 1991. The updated policy provides updated information and expectations regarding school safety patrols at our schools. The policy will be posted on our website for 30 days public comment, and we'll answer any questions you have regarding this policy.
Mrs. Ritchie.
I just want to say thank you. What we discussed during the policy meeting in the position, it made it sound like the school safety patrol were out with the crossing guards and stuff. And so the way that it's worded here is really clear that they are part of that, but they are not anywhere near traffic and doing stuff like that. So thank you very much for making that correction on there and make that more, better understood. Thank you.
Is there any public comment on this? All right, we'll post that one on the web. Item 4.12 is the Violence and Vandalism Policy KG.
And the School Security Office also brings policy KG, Violence and Vandalism, to you for first reading. This policy was last updated December 6, 1989. It prohibits serious threats and violent acts against staff, students, and persons on Anne Arundel County Public School facilities and at our events. This policy will be posted for 30 days public comment, and we'll welcome any questions you have related to it.
I don't have any board comments or questions. Is there any public comment? All right, we'll post this one on the web for 30 days. Thank you. The next item on the agenda is 4.13, update on legislation. This is an information to action item. Do I have a motion to move this from information to action?
Second.
All those in favor? We now have an action item, and we'll be going through each one individually.
Yes. So let me just begin by saying that our General Assembly has been very busy since they opened on January 13th. So far, there has been 507 Senate bills filed and 609 House bills. We are tracking 33 Senate bills so far and 53 House bills. The exhibit before you has some of those, and then you'll be getting more of those at each board meeting throughout the legislative session. So just to kind of familiarize yourself again with this document, and for those of you who are looking at it for the first time, Section 1 of the document is where we're looking for a board vote because we want your opinion on what position or, you know, we should take regarding a bill. Section 2 of the bill, we will not go through the bills individually. It's sort of a four-year information, and for various reasons, we're recommending we do not take a position on those bills. And then Section 3 in the document, your position has already been established through the legislative program that you passed back in November. So with that, we'll start with Section 1, where we are asking for a recommendation. The first bill is House Bill 29, Education Participation in Youth Sports Programs, Concussions, Penalties for Coaches. This bill essentially provides specific ramifications for coaches for not sitting a child out after a concussion. For the first offense, they say that you have to suspend for the remainder of the season. For the second violation, it's that season and the next season, and then the third violation is permanent. Under our current board and superintendent authority, we can already do this. We have a very strong program for dealing with concussions. We, Anne Arundel County Public Schools, actually sort of led the state in what the state modeled their policy on concussions after. And so this bill, while I think well-intended, is very misguided in the way that it would punish coaches, because we have more authority currently than we would if this bill passed. And so for those reasons, we do recommend that you oppose this bill.
Mrs. Ritchie.
Have we shared with Delegate Chang how we deal with concussions? Because we have a real extensive policy, but also a whole rubric that coaches have to follow, plus the trainers that are trained and the concussion awareness that people take and stuff like that. So is he familiar with some of the...
Unfortunately, we have not had individual conversations with Delegate Chang. When I say Anne Arundel County Public Schools, I do not speak to a bill until you guys have taken a position, unless it's covered by our program, and this one has not been. However, through our association's PZAM, the group that represents his public school superintendents, and also MABE, they have spoken to him and tried to explain to him how this actually is detrimental to school systems and takes away our authority. I mean, there may be situations now where we want to take more severe stance on a coach after the first violation because it was so severe. I mean, hopefully that would never happen, but if it were, we have that authority now. This would keep us to only on the first violation, only suspending the coach for the remainder of the season, and then he would be eligible. It gives them increased rights. So to answer your question, we have not individually spoken to Delegate Chang, who is the sponsor of this bill, but our representing bodies through MABE and PZAM, they have expressed to them the problems with this bill.
And maybe we need to just let him see what our policies and what our rubric is in terms of, you know, the awareness and the training that our coaches go through, and the fact that parents have to sign off on things, and that kids have to go and be checked out by doctors, and, you know, and stuff like that. So it's not something quite, and it's not just one person making a decision on the sideline. I mean, you know, it's, there's more than just one person there, so that, you know, we don't have the unhappy circumstances of one putting them back in when the kid has an obvious concussion and stuff.
Right, so. And I think the other way, and this sort of, there was a hearing on this bill in the House already, and in the Ways and Means Committee, one of the points that was brought out is it's not the coach making the decision if the student is put back on the field. There's a very rigorous process where a licensed healthcare provider has to make that determination. So a coach can't overrule that, and we're very specific. This board passed a policy and regulations that are very specific on that issue.
Mrs. Birch.
So I don't spend all of my time reading our bills, but when I did read this bill, I saw what seemed to be a technical problem with the bill, and maybe I read it wrong, but maybe not. Were there any amendments offered to the bill to deal with what I saw as, because I know there were two sections of the bill, one dealing with purporting to deal with school coaches and one dealing with rec coaches. But in the section dealing with school coaches, it said coaches were people who coached games on school property, which are often rec coaches, because many rec games occur on school property. And for those coaches who coach games on school property, it appeared as though the board became the decider as to whether or not those coaches got to continue coaching. Well, I don't know how we get to decide whether or not a rec coach gets to continue coaching, because just because they're coaching a game on school property, I don't really think that we have any. So, I mean, I just want to make sure that as we oppose it, we oppose a poorly drafted bill. Or whether maybe that was intended. Maybe they do want us to become the deciders for rec coaches. I'm not sure. But that's the way I read it because of how the definition was written. So please let's add that to our reasons to oppose this, because I don't want to be deciding whether or not, you know, Gort coaches and Green Hornets coaches and Crofton Cardinals coaches are eligible. You know, I don't want them to appeal to this Board of Education as to whether or not they're still allowed to be coaches. I don't think that's our job. Thank you.
That was kind of my question, too. We don't even want to support with amendments because our policy is already taking care and serving us well.
Definitely. And to the Parks and Rec piece, the there were two gentlemen that spoke at the hearing. I'm not sure that they spoke to that specific technical issue, but they did speak to their opposition of the bill as well.
Okay. So is there any public comment on this bill? So do I have, I guess, all those in favor of opposing the bill? Supporting your recommendation. Tom, I can't see. Are you raising your hand? Or no? Okay, so we have 801 because we're missing a member at the moment. Okay. House Bill. Okay, make it 9. House Bill 41.
Okay, Public Schools Board of Education Anonymous Two-Way Text Messaging Tip Program. This is a bill that we've seen before. It basically requires county boards to establish an anonymous two-way text messaging reporting system so that students can report bullying through a text messaging program. There are several issues with this bill. One of it is just plain and simple. It creates an unfunded mandate for local school systems. We don't currently have a text messaging system that would meet the requirements of this bill. It also sort of creates an idea that someone's going to get an immediate response if they send the text, which means then an individual would need to be manning that text 24 hours. Additionally, we're not clear on whether this can actually stay anonymous, given that all technology leaves some sort of footprint. So for those reasons, we're recommending that you oppose this bill.
I don't have any board comments. Mrs. Ritchie.
You know, we have a program set up. We have an anonymous tip line. It's publicized in all of our schools. We have forms that people can fill out in schools. I mean, we have a lot of various ways to do that. And I would be really concerned as well, because we don't have somebody who's sitting there monitoring a texting thing. And while the intent, I think, is admirable, it really doesn't fit with us, because first off, you're not allowed to have phones in schools. Technically. So, I mean, is the kid violating the policy if he's tweeting? I mean, if he's texting when he's in the classroom, you know what I mean? So we put him in a position to do that. But there's already ways, and I think that they're easily accessible ways to be able to do this. It's not real difficult. And so I continue to oppose.
All right. Mrs. Burge moved to oppose the bill. Do I have a second? And is there any public comment? Okay, all those in favor of opposing House Bill 41. Motion passes 9-0-0. House Bill 115.
Education Robotics Grant Program Establishment. This bill creates a robotics grant program to provide grants to public schools to support and expand existing robotics programs. It requires the governor to include at least $500,000 annually in the state budget to report to support such programs. We're asking, we're recommending that you support this with amendments. Essentially, the way the bill's written is it only would support existing robotics programs, and we have some great existing robotics programs, but we'd like to be able to expand them if we were one who was a recipient of the grant. And so we're asking an amendment to allow for new robotics clubs and programs. And we also want to make sure that the money in the grant is not restricted in such a way that it can't provide for the types of funding that we would need for our robotics clubs. And then we're all, another amendment would be just that the types of robotics clubs aren't strictly just robotics, because we have some great underwater robotics, VEX robotics, and LEGO robotics programs that we may wish to expand at some point, and that's where, if we were to get a grant, we would use the money.
Do I have a motion to support with amendments?
Second.
Mrs. Hummer.
Would these be grants, individual robotics clubs wouldn't apply for these grants? The school system as a whole would apply for the grant, and then the school system would use it for the various clubs?
Yes, and then the MSD would have to establish regulations, so we don't know what they would say, but the way the bill's written, yes, it would go to the school system, and then the school system would decide from there.
Thank you.
Dr. Frank?
Would these funds be available to a charter school?
I believe so, because they're a public school as part of the...
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Horskamp.
So with the grant, would, if a county applies to it, and do they get just like a lump sum, or does it vary on the number of robotics programs in the school system? So like if Montgomery County has more robotics programs, do they get more money?
I don't know how the exact grant system would work. That's usually scripted out more in the regulations from the Maryland State Department of Education.
Okay, thank you.
Is there any public comment on this item? All those in favor of supporting House Bill 115 with amendments? Motion passes 9-0-0. Senate Bill 71.
Public school and non-public school student diabetes management program. This is a bill, again, that was filed last year as well. Basically, it requires each county board to establish a volunteer program for employees where they at each school will have a team or an employee volunteer who will help manage a student's diabetes management program. And there's several issues with this bill, as there were last year. One, it's definitely a workload issue on teachers, because they are going to feel the brunt of those who are going to be encouraged to be volunteers. We feel that many employee volunteers may not actually be suited for this work, and there's no ability within the bill to allow someone not to have to assist a student with their diabetes management if the nurse decides that that employee is not someone that would be able to do that. There's no ability to say that employee can't do that if that employee volunteers. And we're very concerned with using a school volunteer without the training of a nurse to appropriately manage such a complex disease as diabetes. And for those reasons, we recommend that you oppose this bill.
Mrs. Ritchie.
I strongly oppose this. I did last year. I do this year as well. It, you know, it's not as easy as just giving somebody a shot and knowing what you're doing and stuff. In all of our schools, we have licensed nurses. And so that shouldn't be a real problem. I mean, there's a nurse in every one of our school buildings. And I think that to then put the burden on a non-medical professional, you know, while anybody can be taught how to do a finger stick and anybody can be taught how to do certain things, to understand why you're doing it and how come it needs to be done at that time, it is something that you need a medical professional to do. So I strongly oppose this.
Is there any public comment on this item? All those in favor of opposing Senate Bill 71? Motion passes 9-0-0. And now we're to the point.
Those are all the bills that I had requested a position on, but if there's any questions about any of the remaining bills in Section 2 or 3, I'm happy to answer them.
Okay. Mrs. Hummer.
I have a question on the Bill 86, and this is more of a school system question, where the bill would require that IEPs be translated into the parent's native language, and we're opposed to that. Do we offer that as an option for parents that want it? Not as a requirement, but if we had a parent that wanted their IEP translated, do we offer that now?
I believe the answer is no. We offer translation. We offer translation during the meeting.
Right.
And so the parents are accessing that so they can understand what's in the document. But we're not then taking those multi-page documents and translating them into that language. No. But we do have translators there during the conference themselves.
That was my understanding when in speaking with the Department of Special Education. They also sort of explained that it is much more effective in understanding when there can be interaction rather than a piece of paper that's translated that may not accurately reflect what the intent of the document is, especially because in special education there's so many sort of terms of art and specialized terms. If right. It was felt that it's much more
right.
Correct.
Well, that was just one. If there was the request for it, and just another, we have so many. The majority of our foreign language speakers are Spanish. Has there been any talk of maybe translating the forms, at least into Spanish? That's just something I'm asking for maybe perhaps a future time.
I had a couple questions for clarification on House Bill 198, where it talks about the school resource officers, school systems would be entitled to reimbursement from the state, and the reimbursement would come from the board, from the Education Trust Fund. And then in our opposition, we just mentioned that it's cost prohibitive. So are we saying that they're just not reimbursing the whole expense from the Education Trust Fund? I was just trying to understand why it's cost prohibited if there's a reimbursement.
Because if it was coming from the Education Trust Fund, something else is probably not getting funded out of that Education Trust Fund. So if they're taking that money
for this purpose, then,
right. And I think the fiscal note last year was $99.5 million. Mm-hmm. So it's quite a large amount.
And then Senate Bill 65 on the Sugar-Free Schools Act. I know we've had some folks just wondering why we're not supporting it. I just wanted to kind of highlight, like we were talking with Dr. Arlotto, that our nutritional content is already on our website, correct? So if a family member's concerned about their child having too much sugar, they can go and look at the sugar content.
Yes, and we have our food and nutrition services supervisor here, Jody Rissi, to expound upon that for us.
Good morning. For the record, Jody Rissi, supervisor of food and nutrition services. In Anne Arundel County, we do have all of our nutritional data posted. So it not only does an individual analysis that we use NutriKids for, it's a USDA-approved software that we look at calories, protein, carbohydrates, I don't know, 6 or 7 different items in our label, and then we post the original manufacturer's food label as well as ingredient list and an allergen statement on all of our products. So everything is out there for parents, public, community. School nurses use them often to see.
So that can help people make their choice if this bill isn't passed. Thank you. My last question was on the orange ribbons, House Bill 39, Senate Bill 224. We're taking no position. I know there was a discussion at the state level about perhaps opposing or supporting the bill. Can you explain why we've chosen to take no position?
Certainly. And just for the record, MABE, our Maryland Association of Boards of Education, did oppose this bill. We took no position as this board is continuing to examine the issue of healthy school hours. So we felt it not appropriate at the time to take a position on this particular bill. Additionally, there's been some issues raised with the bill since the hearing that the orange ribbon is actually already denoted for another cause, that being self-harm. And so we wouldn't want to in any way crush the spirit of the advocacy that goes on for that particular cause as well.
Okay, thank you. I don't have any additional questions. Is there any other public comment on the other bills?
Hi, members members of the board. My name is Sarah Davis. I'm a parent of children with disabilities. And on HB 86, I urge you to reconsider that bill that is translating IEPs into other languages. As a parent who has sat through many, many, many IEP meetings, and perhaps something that you guys can also appreciate, leaving the meeting, it's very difficult to really remember everything that happened in the meeting. And if you walk away from that and you don't have a document that you can refer to at a future time, that you can understand, that you can use, that puts you as a parent at a very significant disadvantage in supporting your child's education and participating through the course of the whole year, because that IEP governs a full school year. I'm also a disabled Air Force veteran. I was an Arabic linguist. I grew up in Africa. My parents were missionaries, and so I've spoken four different languages over the course of my life. And I can say that having an experience or working with a translator, it is one aspect, and it's certainly very valuable, but being able to go back and look at the document in your own language and spend the time to really understand it, there is no there's no substitution for that. We already translate many documents for school children of special education needs. We, for instance, do the parent procedural safeguards. We offer that in other languages. And really, it's an access law. Parents cannot consent adequately if they don't have a good understanding of it. They can't participate adequately without good understanding. And so I strongly urge you to reconsider your position on that bill. I do recognize that it would cost additional money in order to be able to do that. However, the ability of those parents to support their kids' education, which research has strongly shown in all aspects of education, parental participation and support is strongly associated with improved outcomes, with academic achievement, et cetera. Taking that away from parents who are already struggling to manage in a country that really doesn't accommodate for other languages, it puts them at a significant disadvantage and puts their children at a significant disadvantage. So thank you for your time.
Thank you. Mr. Webb?
The young lady makes a very good point about the translation. I would be in favor of that legislation personally.
Mrs. Birch?
We've had conversations about this in the past and in past years, and it's more than just the translation. It's the translation with the correct technical terms, because there are certain legal requirements that have to be met in the IEP. And so if it's going to be translated, it has to be translated with the correct legal words. So you don't have to have just translators translating the documents into another language. You have to have translators who are essentially special educators who understand the language translating into all of those other languages, which I think is, if I remember correctly from last year, one of our concerns about having to do this, because it would be very difficult, even if we did have endless amounts of money, to find the appropriate qualified people to do this work. So if you are then required to do it, you need to find someone who is actually able to do more than just translate words, who is able to translate these very specific legal concepts, because we could then be held responsible if it wasn't correct, if the person who translated it for us did not translate it correctly, because we have then given it to the parent as the document, and if it doesn't say what it's supposed to say, then that's on us. So there are risks to that. And I know that's not what the community may want to hear, but, you know, as we have to keep that in mind as we're doing it. I know that's always been one of the concerns of this board and our staff in providing translations, because we don't have those people available to do those translations.
Mrs. Nally.
Well, my experience in many, many, many IEP meetings, there were times where we really could not get, as Mrs. Burge says, we couldn't get translators for some of the more languages that weren't as, like Spanish and other. These were others like Urdu and other, and it was difficult. So I don't know how many languages we're talking about in our school system. But I would think we would really need to look at what Mrs. Burge said. We would also need, because I agree with the speaker, I think it does put them at a disadvantage. But it also, if it's not accurately and legally translated, that's not good either. And I also think we ought to look at it before we approve something like this, look at the financial cost and the how well we could find these translators. And I would remain opposed until I saw that, because I think having a bill, a law that requires us to do this would really put the school system at an unfair advantage, although I understand what the speaker and others are saying of the concerns.
Mrs. Summer.
I completely agree with you about having the access for the parents. My concern with this bill would be that it requires us to do, and as we've all said, I can remember IEP meetings that I held myself with families, and there were languages that I had never heard of, and even finding a speaker to translate, it was impossible. And also, many of these families with some of these languages, they cannot read in their native language. So you don't want to make it an automatic requirement that it be translated because they cannot read in their language. So it's not to have a blanket requirement for everything to be translated. I do think it would be something we might want to look into for some of our more common languages that come out, at least have the forms perhaps be translated. I would like to talk more with the school system and find out more about that. But I think this bill is going to limit us too much and tie our hands too much with unforeseen complications and problems when it comes out. But I fully appreciate, and I think we need to do, and I think we do try to make as much access as possible and understanding for our families when they come out, and anything we can do to help that. But I think this bill may hamper us more than it would help us to do that translation portion.
Mrs. Ritchie.
And I'm going to concur with Mrs. Hummer. There are translation services that can translate all these things and do technical translations and stuff like that. So my concern is not so much sometimes not being able to get the words correctly, but it is concerned with the multiple languages that we have and then the cost that becomes an overburdened cost. But I think that for our school system in particular, and I don't particularly like laws like this that blanket and tell you what you have. I mean, we have to decide how we're going to be able to do it best for our – we may find that the number of students who speak whose families don't speak English is way lower than some other counties. I don't – know for sure, but I would like for us in our school system to start to explore at least being able to translate whatever the major language is in our county, which is usually a Spanish. And then you have to go, because then there's also different dialects from different regions, so we have to kind of make sure we cannot translate it into every dialect of Spanish, and so it has to be what's commonly understood, and there's services that do that. But and in the meantime, I would hope that the school system, in the cases where we have translations problems, are helping them by not necessarily translating the document itself, but by putting key pieces in, ensuring that they're in their language so that they can refer back to those. Because here's the other document: if a non-English speaking parent walks in with their translated document and hands it to me as the educator, I can't read it. And so, we have some, we have some issues in that as well. I mean, and I should have a copy of it, but I may not have it with me or, whatever. So I think that we're probably working with our communities to make sure that these things, but I think that it would be beneficial for us to start looking, as Ms. Hummer suggested, into some ways to ensure that at least our major language, and we can't get them all because there's like 100 different languages, and it's just not feasible for us to do that. But in our major languages, that we start looking and making sure those documents are accessible.
Mr. Webb.
I agree with Ms. Hummer's suggestion. This document is too important for us not to at least consider having it published in different languages, as many as we possibly can. This will affect the child's entire school school life. Having dealt with IEPs myself, it's difficult enough as a parent to deal with the IEP in English. Maybe that's something that should be looked at as well. Maybe we can make that more understandable to the layman. But the IEP has been that's been an irritant for quite some time, and I think we can do a better job.
Okay, that's it for this week, right? For legislation.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is 4.14, the Nantucket Elementary School third-party project shade structure. This is an information to action item. Do I have a motion to move this from information to action? All those in favor? We now have an action item. Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend approval of the Nantucket Elementary School third-party project shade structure.
Is there any board questions or comments? Is there any public comment? Mrs. Hummer.
Hats off to the PTA. Good job. This is great. This will be, I look forward to seeing this be built.
Thank you.
You want to say hi and introduce yourself since you made it all the way out here?
My name is Jody Carpenter. I'm the current treasurer at Nantucket Elementary School PTA.
I'm Sarah Pickens. I am the principal at Nantucket.
Lisa Seaman Crawford, Director of Facilities.
Greg Stewart, Senior Manager of Planning.
Any public comment on this item? All those in favor? Motion passes 9-0-0. Thank you.
Invite us when it's done so we can come see it.
Item 4.15 is the Arundel High School third-party project playground equipment. This is an information to action item. Do I have a motion to move this from information to action? Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend approval of the Arundel High School third-party project playground equipment.
You want to introduce yourself?
I'm Gina Davenport, the principal of the Arundel High School.
Welcome. Mrs. Hummer.
Another one. Hats off to PTA and the senior class. This is great. I think this will be wonderful because it's going to help the kids and helps your curriculum. Wonderful addition. Looking forward to it.
We're excited.
It's not every day that a high school principal is going to come forward and support the building of a playground.
Yeah.
So this is very exciting for a high school principal.
Ms. Jackson had some questions for me when I came today.
Mrs. Ritchie.
And just for the televised audience, the seniors will not be playing on the equipment. This is for the preschool, because you may be at home going, why does a high school need a playground? Even though I support that, because they need to have physical activity as well. But this is for the little wildcat preschool and not for the big wildcats.
Mrs. Pickard.
Yes, this is really cool. I just wanted to, since you came all the way here, I don't know anything about the preschool at Arundel High School. Could you tell me a little bit about that?
One of our largest career and technology education completer programs at Arundel is our child development completer program for early childhood education. We have about 45 students every year that graduate with that completer, and they take a series of child development courses working with this particular preschool. They also take intro to teaching and decisions for responsible parenting and complete the program with an internship. So this is a very popular program at our school. And several years ago, the preschool was remodeled, but we did not have at the time the funds to do an outdoor play space for that preschool. So over the last 5 years, we've been saving money so that we could build a developmentally appropriate playground for the preschool so students can plan and observe children in those activities.
Oh, that's fantastic. So when I see that it's not, so when my kids are at soccer practice at Arundel, I'm not going to have to find them on the playground. They're not going to have access to it.
They will not, because it actually will be built inside one of our interior courtyards. Arundel has two large courtyards, and the preschool has access to that courtyard. So this playground will be right adjacent to the preschool and be limited just to access from the interior classroom and then a gate for emergency exiting only.
Awesome. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mrs. Birch.
So my questions involved how are you going to keep the high school kids off of the playground equipment, because I know it's very tempting for all students, but there will be a gate around it.
We're hoping that that is part of the plan, yes.
Okay, okay. Also, in my day, those were the smoking courtyards, so I guess not,
yes,
in,
not anymore.
Not anymore, okay. I'm aging myself a little bit.
This is actually myself. A lot of fun. I didn't know what to expect today, but this is quite enjoyable.
So, and also because, you know, just a little bit more, a lot, you're not the only high school who has a preschool program like this.
Correct.
And, you know, just for people who are out there, you know, if you are staying home with your children, mm-hmm. you know, because it's not daycare, it's definitely a preschool program. What is the fee that they charge per semester for the program?
It's very inexpensive. It's about $40 for the program. And
for the semester.
For the semester. For the semester. Yes.
But you have to keep in mind that there's a lot of days that they don't have class. It goes along with the high school's schedule. But I'm marketing for all of the high schools. So if there are parents who are not sending their children to, another commercial mm-hmm. preschool or church preschool, they should check with their local high school.
Absolutely.
To see if there are spaces in their preschool, because it is a very low cost option and it gives our students an opportunity to practice. And there are teachers in the room, so it's
yes.
not just the students. And the children get a lot of attention because there are so many students who are working with them.
That's very true.
So, and that's something I know that was going on at Arundel, again, even back when there was a smoking courtyard.
I took child development and worked with the preschoolers at Chesapeake in 19... There's a problem with my microphone.
Mr. Horsecamp.
My school also has a playground for our child development program. So Ms. Burge and Ms. Davenport, the high schoolers, do not use that. The Little Knights are only allowed to use that. And it's gated and everything, so it's cool. No smoking courtyards. Not anymore.
Mrs. Summer?
Another question. So is there just one preschool class a day, or is it like a morning and an afternoon?
There's an AM and a PM.
Okay, and it's open to anyone. Do any of our students who are parents, do any of their children attend this preschool? Is that an option?
Well, the age is 4 years old, so we I don't have too many students that have four-year-olds.
We hope not, right? That's to have,
right.
Right, they
but,
would be older.
But I do have teachers whose children come to the preschool.
Okay.
Their regular daycare provider transports them to the preschool to experience the educational portion of their day with
and is
us.
It open to any in the public to
anyone
apply?
In the public, there's an application process and anyone is invited to come.
Great, thank you.
You're
and
welcome.
How many spots do they typically have each semester?
The class is limited to about 18 students per semester because the facility itself is relatively small, and we want to make sure that not only are the 4-year-olds getting the attention that they need, but also the high school students are getting the attention.
So
it's
18
quite an undertaking.
18 a.m. and 18
p.m. Yes, ma'am.
And when is the application due for the community members that would like to have preschool
care? We usually
care?
Start the application process about 3 weeks before the school year begins.
Okay.
So during the summer, they can come up and pick up the application from the main office. Thank you all for the PR. It's great. We're going to have a long waiting list at
yes.
Little Wildcat Preschool.
Mrs. Hummer.
One more question. How many of our schools have this early childhood program?
I'll get you the number in the list.
Okay.
I don't have it off the top of my head.
Okay.
I can tell you that Northeast High School was very helpful and let us take pictures of their facility so that we could model the choices that we make after their playground.
Is there any public comment on this item? All those in favor? Motion passes 9-0-0.
Thank
Go
you.
Go build a playground or buy a playground. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you.
The next item on the agenda is 4.16, the Broadneck High School third party project field house renovation and addition. This is an information to action item. Do I have a motion to move this from information to action?
Second.
All those in favor? We now have an action item. Dr. Orlato, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend board approval of the Broadneck High School third-party project field house renovation and addition.
Second.
Would you like to introduce yourselves?
Oh, Cheryl Hickox, Athletic Boosters.
Ken Kazmarek, Athletic Director.
Thank you. Do we have any board questions? I actually have Mrs. Hummer.
Well,
You might have my question. Go ahead. I'm just curious, the letter signed by the president of the boosters says that the overall project is $625,000. You have $210,000 set aside and matching funds of $210,000. Where's the other $205,000-ish coming from? Go forward.
We've recently returned to the county and the state and the delegates to go for another grant of $250,000. So we have that pending, and we're going to be waiting to see whether we can get that funding.
Another bond?
It's going to be a grant. We've requested for this session for a grant from the state. Not a bond bill. We've already matched the first bond bill.
And what happens if you don't receive the grant?
Well, we're approaching the project in phases, so we have it in three phases. So we're going to correct a drainage issue and then expand the building and then renovate the building. So we have it phased such that as we have the money, we will modify the structure, if that makes sense. We're continuing to fundraise as well. So that's our guesstimated cost of the project. We hope we can come in under that. I don't know how realistic that is or isn't, but we have it such that we can keep the project moving as the dollars become available.
Okay. Is there any public comment on this item? All those in favor? Motion passes 900. Thank you. The next item on the agenda is a review item, 5.01, award of contracts. Welcome. Does anybody have any questions or comments on any of these items? Mrs. Ritchie?
Just a question on contract number 16-086, the contract for student work program. Is this already an existing one? Is this a existing contract? So this contract's been in existence for a while?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And do you know how long it's been in existence?
No, I don't. Okay. We can certainly get that for you.
Okay. And well, then you can't answer the second part, because there's a cost to it, and then there was a concern about the cost, what causes the cost to increase. So I don't know what the original contract started at. But what would cause the cost of the contract to increase?
Well, it is a grant-funded project to begin with, so there's grant funds to cover it. Largely, it has to do with the fee structure that's approved, the number of participants that take advantage of the opportunity to do the work study, the externship opportunities, et cetera. So we're essentially paying, it's almost like we're paying a tuition.
Okay.
But
we only pay up to how much grant we have.
Correct.
So if we get a grant for more, then we can enroll more students,
right,
into the
program. We would like to offer this opportunity to as many students as possible, and as many students as the grant will support.
And because this is students with disabilities, did I read that?
Essentially correct. It's managed through our special education department.
Right. So it's students who have the opportunity to go out and practice some of the skills that they may have learned, like in our life courses.
Correct.
You know, and to
exactly
be able to go
we're
out and
trying
to
give them field experiences, real life experiences in different settings, so that they can aggregate those experiences and then come back, and they are essentially compatible or supported in the school day environment as well. So there's a correlation between their field work and their in-school time.
And I would imagine that, because they're not paid necessarily, because internships usually aren't paid, so they're not necessarily paid from the job that they're at, you know.
Right.
And I'm just thinking about this because I know that a giant down our way has a program where they use the some cognitively impaired students to do bagging of groceries and things like that. So that would be like an internship program. A student may go there to figure out, you know, and we are the ones that pay for that. Is that right? I mean, well, this grant.
In this instance, yes. But there, as you said, there are many, many
I mean,
opportunities
just
out
the
there.
And
this is just one, but the folks in curriculum instruction, and particularly special ed, do a tremendous amount of outreach to find you know, suitable placements, suitable field experiences for the youngsters that wish to do that.
I mean, because there may be an instance where a business had not ever done that before that we've worked with and says, you know what, we may be able to use students in this, but they're not willing to take the burden of the cost of paying at that time. But this internship then, and then it could turn into a paying job for that student or other students as they come along. I mean, it helps to, I can see the benefits both ways for the student and for the business that may not in the have thought about hiring students like.
Right. It's a true partnership between the two entities.
All right. Cool. Thank you.
Mrs. Birch.
So the grant we received is for this amount of money, or how? I'm trying to understand how the grant relates to the contract.
So we compete for the grant renewals. Uh-huh. And then so that is the grant, the funding level of the grant. So we're trying to match the resources, all of these projects that are grant funded. We try not to exceed the value of the grant, obviously. So there's structures to put in place to manage the expenditures to match them up with the revenue
sources.
Okay,
so that's the amount of the grant.
I believe so.
Okay, and so we don't know what it's 2 1-year extensions if we get the grant again.
Everything is predicated with pending availability of funds.
Okay, so, all right, because, it's odd to have like a 5-month contract. I think that was confusing and wasn't sure if like the future contracts would be, 7 months more than that. We'll just have to wait and see what happens.
Right. And also they're aligned with the academic year because most of these field experiences occur during the months when we're in session. So.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
I had a question kind of piggybacked on hers. I was just curious if this grant was capped at this 31680. So like if we had a 1-year extension, we have to spread the 31,000 out over the whole school year, or would we be getting more money potentially?
Well, it's managed through the Maryland State Department of Education, so we're essentially a beneficiary of this grant. So it's part of a state granting authority. So the actual monies are not direct to us. So it requires a state appropriation to the state department, the agency, which in fact then turns around and distributes it to the jurisdictions. But that can vary depending on how much funding is authorized by the General Assembly year to year. It can vary depending on what distribution algorithm the State Department decides to take with it. So there's a lot of moving parts, but again, much aligned with the comments of Ms. Ritchie, I think we try to maximize the number of youngsters that can take advantage of this wonderful opportunity.
So our hope
would be pleased if the funding authorities would increase the grant size. That certainly would allow more youngsters to again be
so
able to.
So we'd hope if we got 10 months worth, it would be more in the 60s.
Again,
that would be our wish.
Anything to increase the opportunities for the students.
Okay. Last item, consent item, also an information to action item. Do I have a motion to move from information to action? Dr. Arletto, your recommendation, please.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend that the Board of Education award contract 15SC-012, Solar PV and Power Purchase Agreement, to Standard Solar Incorporated in the amount of $956,509.80.
Second.
I just love the $874,000 worth of savings. I assume that's our energy bill. Potential savings?
Correct. That's the differential between the purchased price of the solar generator utility versus what we would be paying on the commercial market, for example, through a regulated utility. So the savings is that differential. We'll be paying less per kilowatt hour, essentially. And so for every kilowatt hour that we consume at that lower per unit rate, that translates to savings. And of course, over 20-year period of time, if you're purchasing energy at less than what is on the commercial market, that adds up pretty quickly for an organization our size.
That's great. Mrs. Ritchie.
There were two vendors, is that correct for this?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And there's a whole, just as a refresher course here, there's a whole process that they have to go through. There's a technical piece of it. That and then they're and it's all weighted, and who sits on the, you know, the technical piece of it? I mean, because, you know, you wouldn't want somebody like me on something about solar panels.
Right. So obviously, it's always tailored to the endeavor. In this endeavor, it's principally my facilities folks and the folks from our budget and accounting unit, because that's essentially the two largest subject matter expert pools for here. But the composition of that evaluation committee is always tailored towards what it is that we're buying. But again, specifically here, it would be facilities and operations, and it would be budget and accounting.
So somebody who would understand about solar panels, about the installation of them, about the construction of them, and so forth, so that when these bids come in, when they look at it, because the one bid was like way low, was like what, $200,000 less or something? I think it was on here. But I mean, so it was, that would be a red flag in the first place, because you want things to be a little bit comparable. But they would be able to explain and understand what that meant.
Correct. Three comments. One, we do a tremendous amount of research on anything that we're going to consume or purchase before we venture into the endeavor. So this is not, it's not a requirement that we, you know, begin buying, installing solar panels or buy energy. So it's been a good couple years that we've been looking at this technology, and with solar becoming more prevalent, the cost of the infrastructure is now coming down.
Right.
The technology is developed. The panels are more efficient. They're lasting longer. You know, there's much more experience in it. So the first part of your question is we've been doing our homework for quite some time before we even got to this part. Secondly, the evaluation criteria that any vendor is put through or matched up against is described and outlined in that RFP. So we forecast and telegraph to all of the vendors, this is the points that your RFP has to hit. These are the specific areas that you're going to be evaluated on. And we want your proposal to be tailored to hitting all these, because essentially this is going to be your scorecard, your report card, right? So that's the second piece of it. And then finally, as I indicated in my very first answer, we rely on those subject matter experts who have already done their homework to evaluate that bid, that solicitation, against that scorecard that we've established in advance and let all the vendors know in advance.
Right. And it's not atypical for us not to always pick the lowest cost, because that's another component of it. There's a technical score, and then there's a score for the cost, right?
Absolutely. You want the project to be a success, and certainly the cost of
right.
the project is a portion of that success component.
Right.
But we absolutely want to make sure that we have vendors that have a history, that we have checked our references, that they have stable credit and can access the capital requirements, that have a very good established installed base already, that we can go back and check and talk to their customers, prior customers, to make sure. So the technical score you will find in most of our solicitations, Ms. Ritchie, where there is a knowledge requirement or a skill requirement too. We're not simply buying a commodity, such as we're not buying number two pencils. You know,
right.
There's not a great variance, although there's some, there's not great variance. But when you're getting to a more technical matter that requires engineering, construction, long-term care and maintenance of it, the ability and the wherewithal of that vendor, of that contractor, over a 20-year lifespan, because this is a 20-year contract, is critically important. So the more that a project migrates towards that vein, the more critical that technical evaluation component is, and the greater weight we provide to that technical score versus a simple commodity purchase that would be almost, if not exclusively, price only.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Dr. Frank.
Thank you for being here. I appreciate the time you spent in looking into this. I've got a couple really simple questions. Why buy a solar panel in the first place? Why do we need one? It's got to be expensive. Over what period of time are we going to ultimately break even on the cost?
Right. As we said, it's a 20-year contract, operational contract. We don't own these panels. Certainly, there's an option to buy should we wish, but at the end of 20 years, the contract essentially terminates. And so the costs, we know what our consumption basis is. We provided all the vendors with exactly, with essentially, we've got bills. We know how much we've been utilizing. So we know how much power we consume. We know the rates that we have in force today. We can make some projections on where rates are heading into the future. But as I said earlier, the what started out as sort of like an infant technology, maybe two decades ago, has really matured tremendously. There's been a lot of R&D into solar power. There's been a lot of support and research done, largely federally funded, but there's also international work going on. So the cost, the upfront cost, has come down tremendously to the point that it's now viable. It may have not been there years ago. And again, the quality of that technology, the efficiency at which they can pick up the solar gain and translate that into energy has certainly come down. So our obligation, Dr. Frank, fundamentally is to operate this school district as effectively and efficiently as possible. And I would not be bringing to this board a recommendation to overpay for a commodity that I can buy cheaper. We could have gone into the solar business any time over the last 20 years, but again, having monitored it for that long, we were reluctant to do that largely because of not having the confidence level fully in the technology, but even more so, the economic calculus simply wasn't there at that time. We've crossed that bridge now that these are viable alternatives, and if we're looking to maximize the benefit to the taxpayers and to service our clients, which is our schools, our facility base, then we're at the point that we're bringing this proposal, this technology, before this body.
What is the total cost of the project, and did I understand you correctly that we will not break even until 20 years?
No, sir. We'll break even. We would not, if we broke even at the 20-year point, our savings would be essentially zero. So we are not out of pocket basically paying for the install. We're paying it through the utility bills, through the energy savings.
Let me repeat my questions again. Question number one, what is the cost of the project?
The direct cost to us is essentially zero.
No cost to us.
We're going to be buying energy that's going to be produced. We don't own the panels. We're going to be buying energy that's being produced by these panels at essentially a rate that's prescribed in the solicitation. Part of that rate, just like any other utility, if I'm buying utility from BG&E, I'm paying for Calvert Cliffs, I'm paying for the overhead lines, I'm paying for the high tension wires, I'm paying for all the trucks. So there is a cost to that commodity that you are paying when you are buying that commodity.
How much more money would we spend if we did nothing?
About $900,000 more.
So we're going to save $900,000 over the next 20 years. Is that my understanding?
Correct.
Thank you.
Mrs. Burge.
So I'm doing a little thinking outside the box because of a presentation from earlier today. You know those in the parking lot at Anne Arundel Community College? The ceilings over the parking lot?
Yes.
So we've got playgrounds that want to be covered. Any chance we can put some of these over some of our playgrounds so that they have shade? I mean, that's
something to maybe look into in the future.
You know, the PTA might pitch in a little bit for some of the costs of the structures so that they don't have to pay for the whole thing. I think it's something to look at.
Again, as I said earlier, I mean, this is a technology that continues to advance. We see solar in a lot different arenas now than we did even a few years ago. So I think as time marches on, it will become more prevalent still.
Mrs. Hummer.
So these are going to be put on the property at Fort Smallwood. Are we looking into, perhaps as we're renovating or building new buildings, having them be solar powered? Is that something the school system's looking into?
Looking at, we've not gone there yet. This is a ground-based array on mm-hmm. property at our facilities complex that we know it's a fixed asset. We're not going to be expanding that. It's not going to become a school, you know, requires renovation or replacement. Putting them on school buildings where we have, you know, roofs that need maintenance and access, where you've got HVAC equipment, it becomes a lot more complex. It becomes a lot more costly as well. So the cost dynamics change a little bit. The ground-based arrays such as here, again, we know we have a stable piece of property. The installation cost is lower. We know we don't have to get underneath of it to, again, work on roofs and drains and mechanical equipment. We don't have to beef up structural systems to support additional roof loading. So again, we are looking at that, but our comfort level is not to the same degree with the roof mounted arrays as they are with the ground mounted arrays.
Thank you.
Is there any public comment on this item? All those in favor? Motion passes 800. That concludes the public portion of our meeting. The next Board of Education meeting is Wednesday, February 17th at 10. Prior to that, the next Board Budget Committee meeting is on the 17th at 8 a.m. And the next Board Policy Committee meeting is Wednesday, February 10th at 1 p.m. Mrs. Nally.
I move that we go into closed session to consult with counsel to obtain legal advice on a legal matter and to conduct collective bargaining negotiations or consider matters that relate to negotiations.
All those in favor? We're now adjourned to closed session. Thank you.